Okay, well, I'm Canadian, but Aaron, are you still undecided about the election?
All right, well, my opinion does not matter, but if you are undecided still at home, you're not alone. And that is why we now turn to our wonderful panel who braved coronavirus to come to the studio and join us today.
Starting with former Israeli diplomat and expert on Israel-American relations, Nadav Tamir, and founder and president of the Jerusalem Washington Center and author of the book Broken Values, Gideon Israel.
And we also have Israeli journalist, author, and attorney Ben-Dror Yemini. And finally, last but not least, Yael Patir, the former director of J Street Israel. Thank you all so much for being
Thank
with
you.
Us today. All right, so my first question, I'm just going to swing back to Israeli-American voters that we saw. Recently, we saw all the polls coming out saying that Israeli voters typically are voting for Trump, while the American Jewish voters are typically voting for Biden. You know, why is that? Why is it breaking down that way? Yael, I'm going to start with you.
You need a long answer for that. But I think the bottom line is that the Trump administration has aligned itself with the current Israeli government, with a right-wing agenda, which is a popular stand for Israelis, which is why you see popularity for the president, who's considered to be, you know, the Israeli government's best friend. And with American Jews, you see, as they do, you know, for many, many years now, support for the Democratic candidate, and 70% support.
Nadav, I know that you're among the Israeli minority voting for Biden. Why do you think that the majority of Israelis are wrong?
Because I think Trump is bad for the world, is bad for America, and is bad for Israel. I don't think he's leading the free world as America should. I think Israel needs America that leads the world and is respected by the world, and Trump is not. I think he, on the most existential issues, he made the situation worse. Iran is closer to a bomb. The Palestinian issue, he completely made himself irrelevant. And in terms of Syria, you see that the future of Syria will be decided between Turkey, Iran, and Russia. The U.S. is completely not there.
So I do want to touch on, you know, the policies that Trump has implemented for Israel, specifically the Abraham Accords. So we have normalization agreements with three countries so far. Apparently, there could be up to 10 more. I wonder if you think that the same thing would happen with Biden. If he's elected, will he continue with these kind of agreements? And will we see the same sort of dynamic of the Israel-U.S. relationship, Mr. Yemini?
I wish I could say yes, but I cannot say yes because probably he is not going to follow the same line of Trump. But the main problem, as much as I see it, and it has something to do also with the Israeli society, with Israeli politics. The main problem in what I see in the United States is we are losing the center. No center anymore. We have right-wingers, we have left-wingers. Where is the center? I mean, every democratic liberal society, the backbone of such a society must be the center. And we don't have it anymore. I mean, when I visit in the United States, I know, and I give many lectures, I just know one thing. I cannot say one word about Trump, not in favor of him, not against him, because it became the most delicate issue. And people are becoming more and more extremist to both sides, which is terrible. I don't want it to happen here. I'm not saying that it doesn't happen somehow already, but that's the main phenomena that we see. That's why people have to shield themselves and not to celebrate tomorrow. That's what we all see.
If we even have a result by tomorrow.
Don't you think the president played a role in making it so?
I think in Hebrew we say tirlul. In English, we don't have the right word. Maybe a kind of walk insanity, or I don't know how to translate it. It's not easy. But he did not begin. I mean, I'm not a big supporter of Trump. It's not the story. But the whole story began actually with this kind of lady in the Washington Post who said that... She is coming from liberal arts university, you know, very progressive. And she said, I cannot say any more Merry Christmas because people are going to be made. And she said it something like 5 years ago. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm going to vote for
that's
Trump.
Really the,
I mean, so something happened.
And that's really the extreme
society.
Of political correctness, really. But, you know, Gideon, I know that you've written pretty extensively on this topic. What happened to the disappearing center, as Ben-Dror has maybe has pointed to?
Well, I think regarding the Democratic Party, it's important to note that the, if you want to call it the radicalization or the Democrats going to the extreme, happened before Trump even, you know, stepped on the stage. What happened in 2016 with the Bernie Sanders movement was the culmination of a decade or a generation of young people in America being educated in a different way, not on traditional American values and various other things. It's possible that Trump has accelerated the extremism on the Democratic side, but he wasn't the one who created it.
I do want to bring up Trump's peace plan for a second with the Palestinians. You know, Trump has alienated the Palestinian Authority from any communication since he declared that Jerusalem is the capital of Israel. This question is for you, Nadav. Do you think that a Biden administration could potentially bring the Palestinians back to the negotiating table?
Absolutely. I think it wasn't just Jerusalem. Even before he closed the Palestinian office in Washington, he stopped financing for UNRWA and for USAID project in the West Bank. And then, of course, the Jerusalem move. And the whole plan was a plan only with the Israelis. How do you aspire to do a peace plan with only one side? I think Biden, who's, by the way, a great supporter of Israel and far from any extremism or radicalism, he is the middle of the road guy. As a senator, he always used to cross the aisle and work with the Republicans. He's far from the extremism that people here describe for the Democratic Party. And he will be able to, I think, bring the Palestinians back to the table. And I think he will also support the normalization of Israel in the region, but not in a way to avoid the Palestinian issue, but to actually help solve the Palestinian issue.
I want to follow up on that. I want to disagree.
Not that I'm against peace. I'm supporting any kind of peace, any kind of peace plans that was on the table. I'm supporting. The point is that we cannot forget the fact that before Trump, we had Bill Clinton. Before Trump, we had Obama. And peace plans with something like 97% of the territories Israeli withdrawal was on the table. They always said no. Let's not forget it. It has nothing to do with Trump. It has nothing. I mean, Palestinians are not willing to have the two states for two people solution. They are not. I mean, it's not me who is saying it, it's the Palestinians who are saying it.
So who is more likely to make the Israeli government not willing to get to a two-state solution?
But the question is whether an American president can be a better broker between the sides than the current president. And President Biden could be that.
I'm not defending the Israeli government because I'm not supporting the Israeli policy in the settlements and so on and so on. But when we had the chance to achieve peace, it was the Palestinians who repeatedly said no.
I think it's important to note that Trump hasn't alienated the Palestinians. He's shown them to be irrelevant in the region. They're just, for the past 20, 30 years, the conventional wisdom was that the Palestinians are the center. That's the cauldron. From there emanate all the problems in the Middle East. And Trump has come with a different outlook. And it's shown that the conventional wisdom is wrong. He's shown them to be irrelevant and that movement can be made with other countries throughout the region, peace and better relationships. And I think that's what Trump has shown. It's not that he's alienated them. They're just not relevant.
Can I say something about that? I have to jump on that because the status quo has obviously changed. So let me just say, okay, that I live in Israel and travel around the country, and Palestinians are very relevant to my region. So making them irrelevant is actually a great danger for Israel. Because they're extremely relevant. And I think the right approach, as Nadav said, to normalizing relations with Israel in the region is to use it as leverage.
I think we have to separate between the Palestinian Authority and the Palestinian citizenry, and what I believe has happened is a change in the status quo in terms of no progress in terms of peace and normalization agreements between Israel and Arab countries until the Palestinian issue has been resolved, and that has been circumvented.
Right.
Now,
I mean, that's a development that has already been in play for several years now. I mean,
even many Arab states, including, you know, and leaders of the Arab world have come out and said, you know, the frozen movement between Israel and the Palestinians has forced our hand.
Right, and it will no longer sort of be what we will be waiting for, right, is what we heard from the Emirates. But what I'm saying is that is a development that people who are engaged in this topic and who are trying to promote Israel's relations with its neighbor know that this is already in play. The things that have been this normalization has been happening under the table, and now it's on the table, and that's wonderful thing for Israel, for Israel's security, for Israel's relationships in the region, and for our prosperity, and undoubtedly. But I'm just saying that it has already been the case, and this normalization, I would have liked it to be, would have been, again, leverage to actually reverse
that
course.
So is there a chance that this could potentially be something positive for the Palestinians, and the Abraham Accords could be essentially a backdoor to some kind of an agreement between the Israelis and Palestinians?
I mean, I think that is the hope. I mean, the hope is that going forward with this process, and perhaps the ability to bring in Saudi Arabia, right, which is, I think, the big sort of trophy for Israel, would come in exchange for some positive development vis-a-vis the Palestinians. And I want to say, I don't think that either side, Israelis or Palestinians, at this moment are ready for a peace deal, definitely not for a final status deal, but there's so much that could be done to better the relationship between the sides and to make progress towards something that could be an agreement in the future, and I hope the next American administration will do that.
All right, well, for my final question today, Ben-Dror, I'm actually going to come back to you. You know, many people have alluded to, of course, the ties between Prime Minister Netanyahu and President Trump. Would those closeness of ties between Israel and the United States be any different under a Biden presidency?
Would it look more like when the Obama administration was in power?
Yes, I guess yes, because personal relationships are part of the game. I mean, we have to admit it. I mean, he has his own, even if I'm not a big supporter of Netanyahu, yes, he has this kind of personalities and this kind of very special relationship with Trump. I'm not sure that he's going to have it with Biden. We know exactly what happened in the term of Barack Obama. So it's going to be something like what we already experienced before. I do agree with Nadav that Biden is not an enemy of Israel. I mean, he's not maybe Trump, but he's not an enemy of Israel. I mean, in all his votes, not only him, also Kamala Harris. I mean, they always voted in favor of Israel. So I'm not afraid of them. I'm not afraid of the renewing the two peace plans or normalization with Israel. I only said just one thing, that we, people who are supporting peace, let's not delude ourselves that there is any chance that something will happen just because it's going to be Biden, or that the old offers will be on the table again.
I think that's all. I think you just need to ask yourself. When you're looking at the next administration in vis-a-vis Israel, you have to ask, who do you want sitting in the room? Do you want Mike Pompeo, David Friedman, and Mike Pence, or do you want James Zogby, Bernie Sanders, and Jeremy Ben-Ami?
I think the bottom line here is that, you know, no candidate is going to be bad for Israel, but depending on the candidate, it might affect, you know, the region.
No, but
as a whole.
Depends how you define what's good for Israel.
Sure.
Because
of
one of the things that always worked for Israel was the bipartisan support. And in the last decade, Netanyahu and Trump made it even worse, made the relations only in one side of the politics. And I think Biden, we can bring the relations to a bipartisan approach where also same Republicans, middle of the road Republicans can support, because it made the relations toxic, and it moved many of the Democratic Party away from Israel, and also the majority of the Jewish community, the American Jewish community, away from Israel. And we should bring it together,
sure.
And I think Biden can do it.
And we did hear, by the way, Yair Lapid sort of criticizing Netanyahu for not maintaining a relationship with the Democrats, with the Biden camp. So unfortunately, we will have to end on that note. Mm-hmm. Ben-Dror, Yemini, Gideon Israel.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yael Patir, Nadav Tamir, thank you all.
Thank you all for having us.
Thank you so much for coming.